अभिवादन करता हूं, अभिनंदन करता हूं, और आपने अपने बिजी शेड्यूल से वक्त निकाल करके यहां पे जो वक्त दिया है इस पढ़ाई लिखाई के काम को आगे बढ़ाने के लिए, मैं आप सभी का तहे दिल से स्वागत करता हूं, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। तो कार्यक्रम का जो मेन एजेंडा हमारा है आज का, वो नेफ्रोलॉजी कॉन्क्लेव है, जिसके लिए हमारे बीच में SGPGI की कंसल्टेंट डॉक्टर अनुपमा कौल लखनऊ से आज ही यहाँ पे गोरखपुर में पधारी हैं। तो मैं सभी को एक बार चाहूंगा कि डॉक्टर अनुपमा कौल के लिए एक जोरदार तालियां होंगी। थैंक यू सो मच। और हमारे बीच में नेफ्रोलॉजी के विशेषज्ञ जो गोरखपुर के प्रथम विशेषज्ञ हैं, डॉक्टर आनंद बंका हमारे बीच में उपस्थित हैं, और इसी के साथ BRD मेडिकल कॉलेज के डॉक्टर विजय कुमार सिंह जो कि नेफ्रोलॉजी विशेषज्ञ हैं, इनके लिए भी जोरदार तालियां प्लीज। थैंक यू सो मच। तो प्रोग्राम को शुरू करने से पहले मैं चाहूंगा अपने सबसे पहले IMA प्रेसिडेंट डॉक्टर शिवशंकर शाही को प्लीज एक बार हेड टेबल पे यहाँ पे डाइस पे ज्वाइन करें, और अपने स्पीकर से मैं रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि प्लीज एक बार अभी शहर में काफी प्रोग्राम चल रहे हैं, आप लोगों को सभी को पता होगा, यहाँ पे अभी प्रेसिडेंट भी आए हैं तो उनकी भी कुछ सेरेमनी चल रही है, काफी जो हमारे ऑफिस बेयरर्स हैं वो सभी कहीं ना कहीं किसी तरह से एंगेज हैं, तो काफी लोग नहीं उपस्थित हो पाए हैं, मुझे लगता है कि थोड़ी देर में शायद वो लोग भी आ जाएंगे, देरी के लिए क्षमा चाहता हूँ। सभी सीनियर से मैं हाथ जोड़ के क्षमा प्रार्थी हूँ, शायद कुछ गलतियां हो सकती हैं क्योंकि जो सीनियर्स जो असिस्ट करते हैं डॉक्टर VN अग्रवाल जो हमारी सेक्रेटरी हैं वो इस समय उपस्थित नहीं है, तो शायद कुछ गलतियां लाजमी हैं वो हो सकती हैं। तो अभी आने में शायद देर हो रही होगी। डॉक्टर अजय शुक्ला सर से मैं एक बार रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि डॉक्टर अजय शुक्ला सर, डॉक्टर अच्छा अजय शुक्ला है नहीं, सबसे पहले मैं चाहूंगा कि हम कोई भी, जैसे कोई भी हम ज्ञान की बात करते हैं तो एक अंधेरे को हम दूर करना चाहते हैं, तो सबसे पहले इस अंधेरे को दूर करने के लिए हम जो एक कोई भी एक प्रथा शुरू कर हमने कर रखी है, उसके लिए मैं चाहूंगा कि एक बार हम लैम्प लाइटिंग सेरेमनी को शुरू करते हैं, जो कि हमारे अंधकार जो ज्ञान जो अंधकार है हमारे जीवन में, या कहें कि हम हमारे जो इस नेफ्रोलॉजी रिलेटेड कुछ जो ज्ञान की बातें होने वाली हैं, उससे पहले उस अंधकार को दूर करने के लिए हम सबसे पहले लैम्प लाइटिंग सेरेमनी करना चाहते हैं, तो इसके लिए मैं डॉक्टर शिवशंकर शाही और अपने स्पीकर्स को एक बार इनवाइट करूंगा कि प्लीज आ करके एक बार लैम्प लाइटिंग की चीजें शुरू करें। मनीष और अशोक प्लीज लैम्प लाइटिंग के लिए बोल लिया, कैंडल लेकर के
Thank you. सर्वे भद्राणि पश्यन्तु मा कश्चिदु भाग् भवेत्, न तोहं काम्ये राज्यं न स्वर्गं न पुनर्भवं काम्ये दुक्ताप्तानां प्राणिनाम् अर्थनाशनं।
सो प्रोग्राम को शुरू करते हैं और फर्स्ट सेशन के लिए मैं अपनी चेयरपर्सन डॉक्टर बबीता शुक्ला मैम, मीडिया के लिए आपकी इनके साथ फोटोग्राफ हो जाए प्लीज। डॉक्टर मनीष गुप्ता, of women doctors association Gorakhpur as well, and she has many honors and gold medals in her undergraduate career. She is having multiple paper presentations as well. And he did his DM cardiology from SGICR, and he's a consultant interventional cardiologist currently practicing in his own clinic as a Dr. Lokesh Advanced Heart Clinic in Belanpur, Gorakhpur. His एक्सपीरियंस काउंट्स एज हमारे बीच में एक बहुत ही डायनेमिक फिजिशियन है डॉक्टर मनीष गुप्ता, और मैं बहुत ज़्यादा इनसे एक्सपेक्टेशन है मेरी ये सेशन को बहुत ही ज़्यादा इंटरेस्टिंग बनाने वाले हैं टिल न्यू दिल्ली, एंड ही इज अ कंसल्टेंट एंड फिजिशियन एट बंसल हॉस्पिटल न्यू फ्रेंड्स कॉलोनी न्यू दिल्ली, एंड ही इज हैविंग वास्ट एक्सपीरियंस इन हिज कैरियर। सो आई वुड लाइक टू नाउ गिव द माइक टू द डॉक्टर बबीता टू speak about the
on approach to renal failure, and this talk will be given by none other than Dr. Anupama Kaul. Just now I came to know ma'am is 2 years junior to me, and she has done her MBBS from BRD Medical College. I was calling her ma'am all the time, I can call her Dr. Anupama Kaul now. She has done her PG DM. At present, she is in SGPGI as professor in Department of Nephrology, and she has publications in national and international journals. Her area of research and interest being obstetric-related nephrology. That's very interesting, ma'am. We will have lots of questions for you. And post-transplant infections causing renal dysfunction and acute kidney injury. A warm welcome to you, ma'am, and over to you for this interesting session.
Which is relevant to all of us today gathered here. Now, what is approach to a renal failure? So, can we have the slides, please? Adjacent to the spine, and it plays a very vital role in the functioning of the body. And we know that it helps in maintaining the ionic balance, it maintains the composition of the body, it helps in maintaining the blood pressures, and essentially produces a lot of hormones in the body, which maintains the integrity of the body. So can I have the slides? How do I move the slides? Is there some way to move? This is what happens when the... So this is what happens when the... talk about kidney in general. Now, what is the marker of the kidney injury? So there have been a lot of talk about what are the biomarkers which can actually predict the hemodynamic changes which are actually taking place in the kidney much before the creatinine shows the rise, which I'll be discussing over the period of time. So the urine output, what is called adequate, depends largely on a lot of factors. The most importantly, the age, the physical inactivity or activity the patient goes about. But largely, the normal urine output is about 1.5 to 2 ml per kg per hour. So before we talk about the whole path of the nitrogenous material in the body, and it has toxic effects all over the body, and that's what we call as uremia. The oliguria is less than 100 ml in 24 hours. Hematuria is when there are RBCs of more than 5 per hyperfield, and a proteinuria of more than 150 milligrams per day is considered as significant. So what happens if the kidney fails? As I discussed, that there is going to be accumulation of the waste which is normally taken care of by the kidneys, and therefore the symptoms start happening. They tend to have nausea, they'll have vomiting. You may have systemic infiltrations all over the body. Besides that, because it's not able to excrete out the waste, especially the acids and bases, there is going to be tendency to have metabolic acidosis. There's going to be evidence of electrolyte imbalances causing high patients who are diabetic, maybe high-risk medications, or we say a surgery or a contrast study takes on to these patients, they are potentially going to be at risk to acute kidney injury. And unfortunately, what happens is in these patients, the chances of recovery subsequently becomes difficult. So we classify acute kidney injury on the basis of onset of the illness, and we classify them as acute, subacute, or RPRF, and then we have the chronic kidney disease. Depending upon the etiology, we describe them subsequently, but the basic characteristics of differentiation is when the injuries from hour to days, we call it as acute kidney injury. When it takes weeks to days, we call it rapidly progressive renal failure. And chronic kidney disease is when the illness and the manifestations are beyond 3 months. Besides the onset, a lot of other factors play a role. Chronology of events, the inciting factor, drug history, and systemic features beyond renal involvement. The classical four features which are actually associated with renal disease are edema, and systemic features. It helps us to come to a diagnosis. Probably we are dealing with a systemic manifestation of the disease. By K. Dogi, the definition of AKI was considered as when there was an increase in the creatinine of more than 0.3 milligrams within 48 hours, or maybe a urine output dropped by 0.5 ml per kg per hour for 6 hours. And the staging of the kidney disease was an implication for a poor mortality. But as clinicians, what is more important? An abrupt decline. Mind you, it's an abrupt decline in the renal functions over 7 days or less is how we define acute kidney injury. Before we go into the sub-classifications of AKI, an important terminology which stands very important to all of us is the pre-renal AKI. Now, how do we differentiate between a pre-renal AKI and the acute kidney injury which is there in the kidney? Now, we can take it as the pre-renal AKI is there is hemodynamic compromise in the kidney, but the insult is outside the kidney. And therefore, the kidney is able to conserve its function, although there is an injury in the kidney, there is going to be an effect on the kidney, but kidney has its functioning potential. So you can see here, as you can see, the urinary sodiums are, it holds back the sodium. So urinary sodiums are normal. And you see the osmolarity is well maintained. But when the kidney gets knocked off, when the kidney functions goes off, it's not able to conserve this. So the sodiums get lost, and the bun and the creatinine ratios become altered, and the urinary osmolarity also drops. What is essential here, before we discuss on cases which can actually give us the idea about the etiology and how we identify these patients, there are clinical syndromes which actually come in conjunction to make us have differentials in our mind. For example, if there's a patient who comes with fever and he has hemolysis and acute kidney injury, there are certain differentials which come into mind. Are we dealing with malaria acute kidney injury, or is it sepsis, or intra or intravascular hemolysis? For example, if there is an acute kidney injury, usually acute kidney injury doesn't present with hypertension. Now, if the patient presents with hypertension and acute kidney injury, under these circumstances, the injury could be either in the glomerulus and the chronology of events. Now, this patient developed jaundice 4 days back. Then he had cola-colored urine. You see, oliguria happened. What we were talking about, renal injury, the oliguria came into picture. There was swelling. but you see there was no hypertension in him. So probably we were cola colored urine, and clinical evidences along with the lab evidence of hemolysis as well as what are the causes which can cause acute kidney injury then. You see DIC can present like this, even thrombotic microangiopathy can present like this, paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria can present like this, and of course see malaria as well as enzyme deficiencies can cause. Now so in these conditions, we must know how do we evaluate, how do we evaluate a patient who has intravascular hemolysis. We should see for evidence of jaundice, we should see LDH is high, you have hemoglobinuria in the urine, and then you tend to have in patients with extravascular hemolysis, you may have the Coombs test being positive. So with this background in mind, we investigate this patient, and what was interesting to see as we discussed, he had anemia, he had high reticulocyte count, but there were no schistocytes, the platelets were low, and please look here, he had a urine which was showing just trace proteinuria and bland sediments. As we discussed earlier, I will talk in detail later subsequently, but what is interesting to understand, he didn't have hypertension, he didn't have any proteinuria, very significant amount, and then when we did a kidney biopsy, what is interesting to see is that there is, here you can see the tubular, keeping in mind that there is an inflammation taking place in the glomerulus which is responsible for hemolysis and injury and causing a glomerulonephritis. So what did we learn from these two important cases? The take home message was the inciting factor. Say if a hypovolemia, sepsis or hypotension comes and the chronology of even starts with oliguria. Now this oliguria leads to swelling. Now because the kidney is not able to excrete the sodium and water, it starts getting in and recovered completely. To see here, although he had a cola colored urine, his hypertension was not there, he had pallor and he had edema. What did he see here? To see, he had pancytopenia and his creatinines were high. We do not have an ultrasound available on us, nor any care left behind. So when we investigated him, what was interesting to see, he had pancytopenia, there was evidence of hemolysis, and you see here, the urine, there are no RBCs. There are just no RBCs. So, if in the peripheral smears we do not see schistocytes, so we should get a Coombs done. The Coombs was negative in our cause of hemolysis. All will test positive on a urine dripsticks test. You should always centrifuge the urine. In hematuria, there will be a clear supernatant with the cells in the bottom. But in hemoglobinuria and myoglobinuria, and hemoglobinuria. So I think Dr. Banka will talk more on this, but it's one negative. So what was it here? When we did the flow cytometry for PNH profile, large clones of PNH were found. So here we were dealing with the paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobin, started steroids, he became dialysis independent, and the last follow-up, he had a creatinine of 1.8. The take-home message from this patient is that not all hematuria are glomerular in origin. A careful history, examination. So all about ATNs and glomerular disease. What about interstitial disease? Interstitium is also an important part of the kidney. So we had this 45 years old female who presented with history of belching and bloating, went to a nephrologist with a creatinine of 3, and urine was showing 1 plus protein. There is no hypertension and no other significant finding. Labs were showing there was some anemia, urine was 1 plus, and there were tubular proteinuria only. So what does the interstitial disease behave? Interstitial usually is non-oliguric nature. It doesn't show any active sediments except for there are WBCs in the urine with a normal culture and a normal ultrasound. So keeping a possibility of an acute interstitial nephritis, the interstitium has got affected, and therefore the possible cause could be a proton-pump inhibitor, and once we stop the PPIs, there was a recovery in renal functions. So what does this case teach us? This case teaches us that we cannot take the PPIs lightly, and there is an association between the PPI and the development of AKI. So in the end, it's important to understand that we should discourage the inappropriate use of PPIs only when it is indicated. And physicians should understand that short-term use of even small doses of fenoprazole or these drugs can cause AIN and the acute kidney injury has manifestations in the form of CKD. So, just a brief, so how do you differentiate AIN? AIN usually in the classical presentation of methicillin and penicillin used drugs, they usually used to present with fever, rash and flank pain. There is eosinophilia, there is eosinophiluria and WBC cast. And when we biopsy here, there are a lot of interstitial inflammation. They may be having granular cast as well as granulomas. So just a brief here is how does a interstitial disease behave? Interstitial disease, non-oligotic, you may have eosinophilia, eosinophiluria, WBC cast. Acute glomerulonephritis, presentation with hematuria, hypertension, proteinuria, RBCs in the urine, and the complements can be low. Interstitial disease usually presents with non-oligotic acute kidney injury, with evidence of mild tubular proteinuria, WBCs without bacteria, and there are going to be evidence of eosinophilia. So what is, now when you see this patient, how do I differentiate between an acute kidney injury from a chronic kidney disease? That's a very valid question because you do not get the histories always to the patient. So we look at this 50 years old female who had history of recurrent vomiting and decreased appetite and decreased output. When we took her history, she was detected to be diabetic recently with anemia and advanced renal failure. There was no edema and there was no evidence of end organ damage in the form of peripheral neuropathy, no retinopathy, no hypertension, but she had marked pallor. So to summarize, if you see the labs, she had severe anemia. So we were dealing with a newly detected diabetic, no retinopathy, unexplained renal failure, anemia, out of proportion to the renal failure. You see, there was some AG reversal here. So thinking of possibility, were we, because the urine was bland and there was phase protein, so are we dealing with a tubular interstitial disease or it's an underlying diabetic kidney disease? So with this background, and since she was in the fifth decade of life, we did a bone marrow. There were atypical cells in the bone marrow, almost 35 to 40%. And immunofixation showed IgG, kappa, and lamb. What did we see in the kidney biopsy? The kidney biopsy showed casts in the tubules, and despite recent onset development of diabetes, she had diffuse nodular glomerulosclerosis. So we were dealing with a multiple cast nephropathy along with coexistent diabetic nephropathy. So the take-home message here is that not all diabetics will present to you with chronic kidney disease. There could be an element of AKI in them. We should look for telltale signs of diabetic retinopathy and neuropathy to make a diagnosis of diabetic nephropathy. But doesn't mean that if a patient has retinopathy and neuropathy, he will definitely have diabetic kidney disease. There could be possibilities of other causes, and one should screen and understand and investigate the patient accordingly. As we discussed, investigations play a big role, and I think Dr. Vijay is going to talk about it in detail. I'll just highlight an important thing here, is that the urine is like a mirror for a nephrologist. You see the proteinuria, the urine sediments make you come to a diagnosis quite evidently, understanding that if there are WBCs in the urine, you could either be suspecting there is inflammation in the interstitium or there is an infection. If there are RBCs in the urine with cast, you probably are dealing with a glomerular etiology. So does 1 plus 1 mean 11? So it's true for clinical diagnosis because sometimes labs help in making arrive to a diagnosis. So we had a 65 years old female. She had history of back pains off and on for 8 months, and then she presented with decreased appetite, nausea, and vomiting, and she had a creatinine of 2.8. She was being given history of calcium carbonate supplementation and very high doses of vitamin D in last 6 months, but there was no history of any NACIs. So she was hypertensive. She was dehydrated. Investigations showed us that she had anemia. She had a creatinine of 4.6, but there was no AG reversal. You see, calciums were 13. She had a uric acid of 11. She had no proteins, no RBCs, occasionally WBCs. So we were dealing with hypercalcemia with AKI. Now, whenever we see hypercalcemia with AKI, the first investigation should be a PTH. And if the PTH is high and the ratio of calcium to creatinine is high, we are arriving to a diagnosis of primary hyperparathyroidism. But if the PTH is low, you should always get a 25-hydroxy vitamin D level done to make a diagnosis of vitamin D intoxication. If it is 125-hydroxy vitamin D, which is high, which gives you idea that we are dealing with an inflammatory granulomatous disease, could it be sarcoid, could it be lymphoma, could it be tuberculosis, and then we should screen the patient accordingly. So, this patient, so possibilities could be hypervitaminosis, she could be myeloma because she had a lot of bones in the aches and pains, and could be a granulomatous interstitial nephritis. So when we investigated her, her vitamin 25-hydroxy vitamin D was very high, her PTH was suppressed, there was no evidence of myeloma, and the AC levels were normal. So, understanding that she was hypercalcemia induced by the supplementation, we just hydrated her. Her hypercalcemia settled down, her renal functions improved, and follow-up, she had a normal renal functions and a stable vitamin D levels. There has been a lot of literature work which says that vitamin D intoxication is not rare and hypercalcemia with AKI should be carefully evaluated. Another important case where investigations really helped us. I mean, at this period of time, this was way back in 2015, we were naive, and I think Dr. Banka and Dr. Vijay will also agree to what I'm going to talk about here is that at this period in 2015, this was a 12-year-old male who presented with a history of fever and flank pain. Over the period, when we saw he was dropping your output, he was dialyzed outside, and day 18 he came to SCPGI. You see, here he was hypertensive, he had edema, he had pallor, he had normal height and weight. Understanding, because he had anemia and he had hypertension, could there be a CKD element on this? But then the height and weight was proportional for his age. He had right flank tenderness, some hepatomegaly, but no feet weight. Interestingly, you see, his hemoglobins had dropped, he had to be given transfusions, his PLCs were high, creatinine was high, and his PTINR was delayed. So, it came into our mind, and the urine was showing WBC of 22.5, so were we dealing with some kind of sepsis or infection which was actually causing this child to go to have high PLCs and PTINR derangement. So what we did was we did an ultrasound, and the ultrasound showed a bulky kidney with possibility of an abscess in the lower right side of the kidney. This was a CT. You see the hypoechoic shadows in the kidney, and labs, if you see the labs, the hemoglobins were dropping, the PLCs were rising, and platelets dropped, INRs rose, and his OTPTs were very high. So we were still in a dilemma, were we dealing with, say, because he had hypertension to begin with in the initial period, he had anemia, and then this, all this stuff going on. Are we dealing with thrombotic microangiopathy, or are we dealing with sepsis in this patient? To our surprise, we did a Doppler on this patient, and you see, in the initial beginning on the 7th, we saw the renal flow was marginally restricted. But day 3, he had no flow detected in the bilateral renal arteries. There was an inflammation which intact the vessels, and what could, and in the backdrop of an infection, what it could be? It could be a fungal infection which was actually invading the vessel of the kidney and causing anuria in this patient. Although the cultures and the urine can show active fungal infection. We started him with IV antibiotics, amphotericin. Unfortunately, this was the first experience with this patient. He was put on a mechanical ventilation. Unfortunately, he had refractory shock and death. So we were still in dilemma, what actually happened to this patient. So what we did was a post-mortem biopsy. And you see, there's cortical necrosis happening in the kidney, and this element of fungus you can see here. So what did this patient teach us? That there was a complete necrosis with presence of fungi, and probably we were dealing with an acute cortical necrosis, possibility of a mucor, and in a immunocompetent. So there are case reports, and as Dr. Banka and Dr. Vijay will see, you have over the period learned this lesson that whenever the patient comes, a male especially, who comes with anuria, with history of fever and history of antibiotics not responding, we should always get a Doppler done to get to see what is happening to the vessels. And this is essential because this is a treatable condition, and now we manage these patients quite well. We do get a biopsies done in these patients and nephrectomy. Even nephrectomies have saved these patients. So this is a learning lesson. I mean, we learned it the hard way, but this is what we felt we should share with this. So definitely fever, flank pain, acute kidney injury, urine should be done for fungus. Enlarged kidney, loss of vascularity, hypoid shallows, do kidney biopsy. It's a high index of suspicion should be given, especially in males who are not responding with UTI on antibiotics. So learning lessons, we should have instituted the antifungals early. A biopsy at early stage would have had us through, and nephrectomy could have helped this patient. There are pitfalls in acute diagnosis of acute kidney injury, understanding that both urine output and creatinine just reflects a functional damage. And there is lack of sensitivity, as we discussed about creatinine. And so there is a lot of talk upon the biomarkers. Now these biomarkers is something like a kidney attack. You see, biomarkers will tell you about a subclinical acute kidney injury happening to the kidney. See, when we have a heart attack, you see what happens. The troponins and the CPK-MBs rises. So is there some biomarker who can tell you that the kidney is at attack? So which could distinguish between the hemodynamic AKI from the renal, actual renal parenchymal illness? So there has been a lot of debate on this. A lot of biomarkers have been identified over the period of time, which actually could tell us, because if you see the subclinical acute kidney injury will progress, there will be loss of renal functions if we have long-term and short-term complications in these patients. So where do we stand? When there is a damage, means the biomarker is high, the creatinine is stable. This is our subclinical AKI. But what we have seen is there have been no clinical trials which have actually incorporated these biomarkers into clinical decision making. So we're still in dilemma what to do, when to pick them early, and how to pick them early. There's a new terminology which has come, is acute kidney disease. Now you see, this is AKI, what we said, day, hours to days. Now this is chronic kidney disease, we said beyond 3 months. So what is going to happen in between this? So that is considered as acute kidney disease. So why it is important? Because we must reassess what is the underlying etiology. We should check for the adequacy of perfusion, need for renal replacement therapies, avoid nephrotoxic drugs, adjust the renal medication, because you see there's a transient AKI jumps to CKD, and this, if it persists, will progress to CKD. So one has to be cautious on that. An important condition, what is RPRF? We've talked about acute kidney injury and talked about subject condition. RPRF is rapidly progressive renal failure. Onset, days to weeks. We have this 50 years old male who was a diabetic on OHAs, presented with pain abdomen, rashes, decreased urine output, and edematous illness. He was hypertensive. There were purpuric rashes over lower limbs. In the fundus, understanding he was a diabetic, the fundus was normal. And interestingly, you see, we have this patient who's a diabetic, non-diabetic retinopathy, pain abdomen, purpura, RPRF-like presentation. So the complements are normal here. The ANA and GA, which we would work up for vasculitis in this, was negative. The cryo could also be a possibility because of the rash and all this, that was negative. You see, urine is full of RBCs. So we were dealing with a progressive glomerular illness which was happening. And what could it be? It could be HSP, it could be cryo. With this background, we did a skin biopsy. It didn't give us much clue. Perivascular inflammation in the dermis was found. And you see, this was the kidney biopsy, which showed focal proliferative glomerulonephritis with ATN changes with IgA deposits. So we were dealing with a diabetic with Henoch colling purpura, because the important features of Henoch colling purpura is palpable purpura, abdominal pain, renal involvement. And we dialyzed and started him on steroids, and to our encouragement, his renal function stabilized when we discharged the patient and on follow-up. You see, he had normal renal function and trace proteinuria, suggesting that he didn't have diabetic nephropathy in his biopsy, suggesting that not all diabetics will have diabetic nephropathy when you biopsy them. So it's important. Why? Because it's not going to be restricted to the organ per se. It can involve the heart, so you should have a clear auscultation of the heart. It can involve the organs. It can cause mentation disbalance. It can cause cranial and peripheral nerve involvement. Joints and skin all can get affected. So it's important because there are mimickers to vasculitis. Now vasculitis is a renal emergency because you need to have immunosuppression because they are lifeline for these patients. Especially in patients who have pulmonary renal syndrome. When there is a pulmonary involvement and then a renal involvement, they are going to bleed in the lungs. And therefore, immunosuppression and plasmapheresis are indications. And therefore, we should rule out all other causes, understanding with the presence of systemic features, with or without them, one should come to ruling out other possibilities. Are there infections? Are there connective tissue disorders or drugs which are causing this? We should rule all these out before we come to a technical diagnosis. Let's talk about an important finding. We said anuria. Anuria is very rare in AKI. Acute kidney injury never presents with AKI. And there are only few causes which can present with AKI and anuria. One is cortical necrosis, bilateral obstruction, vascular cause like thrombotic microangiopathy, and eccentric GA. So let's discuss this 14-year-old male who presented fever, prodromal system, like jaundice and total anuria. He was ictric, he had severe pallor, he had organometallurgy. He was diagnosed to have viral hepatitis and was referred to STPGI and was admitted in pediatric gastroenterology. He was later transferred to nephrology because of his total anuric state. And what was interesting to see that he too had evidence of low hemoglobin, low platelets. You see, he had very high counts. Or maybe a neurologist come across with seizures and confusion. If he sees evidence of thrombocytopenia, raised LDH, presence of schistocytes, anemia, absent Coombs, no DIC, a thrombotic microangiopathy is important. Understanding that it causes endothelial dysfunction, underlying as acting as a second hit because of an underlying complement dysregulation, it causes platelet consumption, clotting of blood vessels, occlusion of vessels, inflammation, and multi-organ involvement. So this slide I put because I wanted to discuss that this kind of condition can be experienced by a lot of us. Obstetricians, you see, you find these ladies who come to the patient after they deliver, you find that they're totally anuric. You think, and then there is hypertension. You think, is it preeclampsia post-delivery or whether it's health which is happening to her? What is it, APS, antiphospholipid disease? Well, there could be a possibility of thrombotic microangiopathy in her. Diarrhea presenting in pediatricians, could it be typical HUS, could it be hypovolemia, hypertension, or could it be PME itself, which is actually causing, the diarrhea has acted as a second hit to an underlying endothelial dysfunction. It could come to a neurologist, he may consider these seizures as part of CVA, or could be infection. One must also think about thrombotic microangiopathy in these patients. So, how do you approach these patients? For to confirm a microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, you should have evidence of hemolysis, negative DCT, presence of schistocytes, and after ruling out DIC and mechanical valves, the etiology of diagnosis of TMA is quite high. So what we did in this patient, we got battery of investigations involving all the viral markers. So we came to a conclusion that we were dealing with a viral hepatitis of unknown etiology with TMA with AKI. We started him on hemodialysis and plasmapheresis. He improved. His output improved after 20 days. And what was interesting here that on the day 10 of admission, he suddenly developed headache and paraplegia. What happened? The MRI showed obstructive hydrocephalus with aqueductal stenosis due to gliosis or a low dose grade glioma. We did a TP shunt. You see, this is the aqueductal stenosis which can be seen in this patient. And after the TP shunt and the plasmapheresis, the child was discharged with normal renal functions, normal LFTs, and the neurosurgery follow-up doesn't show any progression of hydrocephalus and glioma. So what does it teach us? It teaches us that infections could be a trigger for an anuric AKI in the backdrop of a complement dysregulation. Here the trigger was a viral hepatitis. Plasma exchange both helped in the renal recovery as well as the extrarenal recovery. So how do you manage these patients? Since we know that the at-risk group should be prevented, we should carefully monitor and fluid balance their patients, avoid drugs on them, And once we recognize the disease, one should be careful on looking for any signs of recurrence. So we should respond in case of sepsis, start good antibiotics, hypovolemia, assess the fluid status, obstruction, scan the ultrasound, urine examination will help us to come to a diagnosis, and importantly, stop clinically if their patient is diabetic resistant volume overload, if there is hyperkalemia, if there is metabolic acidosis, if there is pericarditis or drug intoxication, we may start dialysis. So early versus late, a lot of debate has been there, but there are no benefit of early versus late. And a lot of studies have shown that one shows no benefit over the other. This slide very well shows that acute kidney injury doesn't recover completely. It's causing cardiovascular events, causing disability, diminished quality of life, and even mortality. How do we differentiate with AKI from CKD? Well, if we have a baseline creatinine available, which is normal, we are dealing probably with AKI. If we have a reduced kidney size, a chronic kidney disease is high. If we have anemia, bone abnormalities, we are probably dealing with chronic kidney disease. Oliguria may or may not be present. PTH is usually elevated in chronic kidney disease. There are some odd pointers to this. Usually, because the cysts are producing erythropoietin, you may not have anemia in ADPKD. Bony changes and anemia is a common manifestation of an interstitial disease rather than a glomerular disease. So, a history is important, a duration of more than 3 months. Glomerular illness suggests swelling, hypertension, oliguria, hematuria. Interstitial disease suggests anemia out of proportion, bone disease, and no edema. Vascular disease presents with uncontrolled hypertension, flash pulmonary, absent pulses, unequal kidneys. These all suggest a vascular etiology. This is what we define by KDIGO, how we define chronic kidney disease. Essentially, all individuals with the marker of kidney damage, with the eGFR less than 60 ml, at least on two occasions, 90 days apart, is the ideal definition for CKD. Even renal histology or a structural change can also classify into chronic kidney disease. These are important definitions. We see the ESRD is when there is no reversibility and you need to have a replacement therapy. The timely vascular access creation is the cornerstone, and we should consider for creation of vascular access when the eGFRs are between 15 to 20 ml. These are the etiologies of chronic kidney disease. As we discussed, there were some, always the kidney who has chronic kidney disease has small size kidneys. But there are causes where the kidney size may be normal despite being chronic kidney disease. One is diabetic nephropathy, ADPKD, obstructive uropathy, HIV nephropathy, and amyloidosis, which despite being chronic kidney disease will have a normal kidney size. Issues, as we discussed, when the kidneys are going to be knocked off, there's going to be volume overload, there's going to be hyperkalemia, there's going to be metabolic acidosis, cardiac involvement, ischemia, anemia, restless leg, nausea, vomiting. I mean, we must understand the once the kidney goes off, it can involve any organ of the body. Usually, chronic kidney disease in the stage 1 to 3 are symptomless and is undetected. Therefore, there are certain signs which we must pick up early. One is unexplained anemia, hypertension, swelling, nocturia. Nocturia is a very important feeling. What is happening is the ADH actually regulates the circadian rhythm. Now, when in chronic kidney disease, the ADH goes haywire. And therefore, the patients start voiding in the night, and that's a very important history to differentiate from an acute kidney injury from a chronic kidney disease. We should have important conditions like ethnicity. African Americans are prone to chronic kidney disease, obesity, family history, especially young children present with precocious gout. We should always think of chronic interstitial disease. Are they because of familial etiology? Patient with bilateral contracted kidney, normocytic normochromic anemia, hyperphosphatemia, and raised PTH. Management wise, diet modification is essential, salt and fluid restriction, fluid physical activities required, maintenance of hypertension and diabetes, optimization of anemia and acidosis, early creation of fistula, and transplant is the best option for renal replacement therapy. So take home here is creatinine, an insensitive marker, need for a newer biomarker. Onset of illness classifies the kidney disease. Identify at-risk population. All cola colored renal is not hematuria. Chronology of events, oliguria, swelling, hypertension, guides to the etiology of the disease. AKI can progress to CKD, so it's not benign. Anuria with AKI is rare. We need to have differentials including infections and thrombotic microangiopathy. K kidney disease, are you the small size kidney, anemia, raised PTH, but it's not always. CKD in the stage 1 to 2 are unnoticed. You should look for the telltale signs. Optimization of electrolytes, acid-base, nutrition, hypertension are key for better outcomes. Early creation of fistula is key for initiation of renal replacement therapy, and renal transplant is the best choice for renal replacement therapy. And in the end, I would say, disease may be full of dilemmas and challenges. A true clinician is one who uses his wisdom and expertise in timely managing it. Thank you so much for patience.
Ma'am, I have a question to ask. Recently we had a pandemic in which we had seen
every organ, and kidney was no less. So it involved the kidney. There was when we also saw a lot of patients during the COVID times. It was there was no other place where they would go for dialysis, and there the COVID per se is known to cause injury in the kidney. Besides the other factors like sepsis and all contributing to it, but COVID per se is known to cause severe injury in the kidney as such.
Kind of renal failure that actually occurred, is it interstitial?
Tubular. It has been seen. Tubular. Even glomerular injuries have also been seen with COVID. We had one patient, interestingly, I'll tell you, we had a transplant patient who actually came, who had COVID, and just after the COVID, he came, once COVID recovered, he came with rapidly progressive renal disease, and actually it was actually COVID which had caused progression and active inflammation in the glomerulus, and which was causing the renal injury. So it COVID can
belong to the same age category, but some of them they do have manifestations of acute renal injury with lower creatinine levels, while the others they are absolutely normal. I mean, they're close to 40 odd age group. There'll be patients who have similar creatinine levels, but some of them will be too symptomatic, others would be absolutely normal.
That's what I was talking with madam also. See, what is very important to understand? What incites the renal injury? Whether it's an acute insult. An acute insult will always have manifestations much more earlier than the signs appearing on them. So as to a patient with chronic kidney disease, what I was trying to say is 1, 2, 3, they'll have subtle change. You will not be symptomatic at all. And even what more is important is thing I do not stress on that point. Any situations like stress, even hyperglycemia, simple fever can cause these labs to go haywire. Even volume depletion, even patients with malnutrition can have a normal creatinine despite having the kidney disease. So a lot of factors play a role when you look for creatinine as a value in these patients.
Mass is less.
Therefore, the creatinine is going to be formed from the muscle. And if there's no muscle, even you see a lot of liver disease. It's very interesting to understand that patients with liver disease, patient will be symptomatic, but you see the creatinines are not very high. But you may have to dialyze the patient early because the volume component troubles them. And that is the reason we initiate dialysis on them early. Because the muscle is the site where the kidney is going to actually, protein is metabolized in the liver. And the liver is not functioning, even then you will have dissociation in the creatinine and the values.
Low pressure pulmonary edema as we have.
Yes, what I was trying to say, why there was a lot of discussion is that creatinine actually talks about the structural challenge. You see, challenges are when we are dealing with patients like cardiorenal syndrome. We're dealing with hepatorenal syndromes. Those patients, there is only hemodynamic changes which are happening and causing injury to the kidney. And therefore, sometimes these smaller injuries, when they add on to each other, they can cause this patient to have a chronic kidney disease. Wherein the injury was not there in the kidney earlier on, it is added on because of the underlying heart or liver disease.
We as obstetricians, we are treating so many patients of preeclamptic toxemia and sometimes HELLP syndrome and eclampsia also. What be your take on how careful we should be with such patients, or rather what precautions should we take?
Ma'am, this is my favorite topic and I love to discuss on this. And actually what is interesting to understand here is that there is a lot of changes have happened over the period of time in understanding the pathophysiology of preeclampsia, HELLP and everything. Now what it is important is preeclampsia usually will not present with advanced renal failure. They will have mild renal failure. It can have a similar presentation like we have in the post, like this patient had a post-transplant, post-pregnancy PMA. I was discussing with madam recently that we had a female who delivered normally. She was nulliparous and she delivered normally. And just 6 hours later, the obstetrician called me. She was known to me and she called me up and said, "Hey, ma'am, the patient is not producing any urine. What do I do?" I said, "Ma'am, what happened exactly?" She said she didn't have hypotension. She was sure for it. She was had a cesarean section and she did not lose a lot of blood. I said, "Ma'am, you send the patient immediately to me." Last 5 years, as Dr. Manka and Dr. Even Dr. Vijay will understand, we've come across a lot of patients with thrombotic microangiopathy. They will always present like this, total anuric status. But in patient with preeclampsia, this patient will also have hypertension. The anuria is a very clinical problem of thrombotic microangiopathy, which will not be in preeclampsia. Preeclampsia will always present in moderate preeclampsia. Health will improve after the delivery happens. Preeclampsia will improve after delivery. But there can be a group of patients in health also. Post-delivery, they can also have health to precipitate, even preeclampsia to precipitate. But they will have always mild disease.
So how do we, worried. That's what I'm operated to. A patient and
I
then
that was the story with that ma'am also.
So how do we explain it to the patient?
That is what I'm trying to say. Yes. It is very important to understand how do we think. Importantly, understanding, you get an ultrasound done, you get a urine examination done, see for the degree of hypertension and look for evidence of hemolysis. If there is evidence of hemolysis and anuria with hypertension, do not think of anything else. Just send the patient to a high. Dr. Banka is here and Dr. Vijay is here. You can send them. They can have
hemolysis with the HELLP syndrome.
We can have HELLP syndrome having hemolysis. But you see, all these patients will improve after pregnancy is over delivered. Now, this patient tends to have it postpartum. And immediately, and the lady, what I tried to say was she was shifted to our hospital, and to our surprise, for 2 weeks we were in fix what to do. She started her early. See, plasmapheresis, we started plasmapheresis on her early, because you see what happens in thrombotic microangiopathy. It is a kind of a two-hit theory. She has, you see, pregnancy as such causes the NMDs values to go down. It causes you, it's hypercoagulable state. So what happens is, in these patients who have an inherent coagulation dysfunction, an injury like a fever, injury like an infection, puts a second trigger to the patient. And that is responsible. You may have at times, even you have high signs of infections, you may have high procalcitonin levels, you are in dilemma whether are we dealing with DIC. It's always better to do plasmapheresis early in this patient on antibiotics.
So the house is open for questions. Anyone has, any ma'am has already explained it. So
what is the age of that, and where can you should use the MDRD?
Back that time the protein restriction was to be done, and then subsequently they said there was no protein restriction required in the MDRD formula. So formulas vary accordingly, but as of date, EPI, MDRD EPI is the best equation for all patients. See, what even madams, the gynecologists and obstetricians always have a problem. What formulas to use for pregnant female? Because see, the creatinine is going to go down in pregnancy. So how do I differentiate which formula to apply? What is the definition for AKI in pregnancy? So there are a lot of debates on those. So because the creatinine is going to come down, so what for you a creatinine of 1.2 will be normal. For a female, it will be very high. So where do you stand? So the criteria vary to a lot of extent depending upon the age, depends upon the if the patient is pregnant or she has other etiologies along with it. But ideally speaking, we use CKD EPI as the formula of
treatment. Ma'am, you spoke about proton pump inhibitors. I mean, that was really scary
because I wanted to bring this into the house, because this we have seen. I was just telling madam, and the lady who was there, she was a staff nurse to us, and we went to see a consultation to her ward, and she showed, "Madam, I'm having a lot of belching and all. I have taken pantoprazole for 2 weeks, and what is happening is I'm having a lot of nausea." I said, "You get your LFTs done and you get your LFT and RFT done." And she came to me running in the OPD, "Ma'am, mera creatinine 3.4 ho gaya hai." I said, "Get a urine." She was urine had 1 plus protein. I said, "Stop PPIs." And we have seen in our setup, a lot of patients are coming with PPI induced AKI, and they're
taking for months together. So many patients are coming, so they're taking it on their own for months together.
That was the real
struggle. I only protein, no carbohydrate. Yes. What is the impact on the kidney?
So there is on very high keto diets and the rice reduction and drugs and and even protein powders, which are, and they land up with acute kidney. A lot of toxins are released, and keto diets. You see, keto diets in when we talk about diet modifications in CKD, which I did not touch very firmly, is that what is a diet for a? I understand, sir. I got your point. I said there have been data to suggest that patients on high protein contents are known to, because protein is causing, going to cause vasodilatation in the kidney, and that is going to cause the injury in the kidney. So there is a lot of data to say that these drugs are not safe and one has to be cautious while using these drugs. Importantly, we have to also understand, when we talk about diet modification in CKD, how do you modify a diet in a patient who is already malnourished? Indians are so malnourished. So one has to be, one has to take in account a lot of factors when you are diet modifying. You, when you see a creatinine of 1.2, 1.4, everybody says stop protein, stop the protein diet in your diet. I mean, you have to see what patient you are dealing with, what group of patients you are dealing with. He's an elderly patient. His creatinine is definitely going to be high with age. Whether there is going to be hypertension, whether the patient has is a vegetarian, whether the patient has any physical inactivity or physical activity, all those factors play a role. We need to modify drugs because we need to restrict proteins, but that is, depends a lot of other factors also when we deal with these patients. So a lot of factors come into play.
What exactly is the point where should we should start the
anti-hyperuricemic? That always happens. Uric acid, there are a small group of patients who have a tendency for, like I was talking about the familial etiology of hyperuricemia. These patients, there are a group of patients who present with precocious gout in the early period of at the early age, and that's how you pick up the chronic kidney disease in this patient. But as such, there is an association of hyperuricemia with hypertension and CKD. But if the patient is asymptomatic and has high uric acid, we do not have to do anything for that. That's for sure.
At what level of uric acid you should start the treatment to prevent the...
Yes, there is, the patient should be symptomatic when, and then you what happens, even you start it, doesn't matter, even you do not start it, doesn't matter, but symptomatic patient with hyperuricemia and CKD should be done.
Thank you so much. I think it was a very great session. So now I would like to invite Dr. Shalin sir to please felicitate our guest speaker, Dr. Anupama Kaur ma'am, please.
Thank you so much.
Dr. Babita Shukla ma'am, Shankar Shahi Boss, to felicitate our chairperson, Dr. Lokesh Gupta. And Dr. Kanhaiya Agrawal. Dr. Sanjeev Gupta is a well-known physician. He doesn't need any introduction. And Dr. Kanhaiya Agrawal is a DM endocrinologist to have his talk on approach to urine analysis.
Anupakal ma'am and Scientific Secretary Dr. Prakashan Sai, I thanks all to just invite me to talk on this small topic, which is already told by ma'am, almost each and every slide is covered. So this small topic, this urine examination, I just explain in, I just tried to explain this in an interesting way. Though it's very small topic, in battery of investigation, just one topic, that is urine examination. So how we find some hidden clues that which part of kidney is affected in urine analysis basically. The major function of kidney is to filtrate all the waste product of our body, which usually form during the metabolism. these are basically nitrogenous waste products. Just to imagine, basically, jitne bhi waste product hai, they enters in the kidney through renal artery, and they after entering the kidneys, they filtered in the glomes. After filtering from the glomes, if the all part of filtrate is filtered, just imagine that around 180 liter of filtrate was filtered per day in the kidneys, but maximum part is reabsorbed. I basically focus. मैंने केवल वही focus किया है जो हमारी clinical settings में important है कि हमें day to day care में patient को कैसे पहचानना है कि कौन सा patient हमारे लिए important है. एक छोटे से investigation urine से. Urine examination readily available है हर जगह, मतलब available है, बहुत cheap. I think मतलब हमारे जितने भी investigation है उन सब में सस्ता जो है urine को पहचानने में कि कौन सा patient serious है, कौन सा patient serious नहीं है. और जैसा अभी मैम ने कहा कि creatinine एक बहुत ही अच्छा मार्कर नहीं है किडनी फंक्शन का, बट एट दैट टाइम बेसिकली यूरिन हेल्प्स कि पेशेंट को कोई प्रॉब्लम स्टार्ट हो रही है. लाइक किडनी कंपनसेट, हर ऑर्गन कंपनसेट करता है. बॉडी ने बहुत अच्छा, मतलब अपने ऊपर वाले ने इतना अच्छा बॉडी बनाई हुई है कि हर चीज़ को कंपनसेट करने की कोशिश करती है. जब तक 50% किडनी अफेक्टेड नहीं होती, क्रिएटिन बढ़ता नहीं है, बिकॉज बाकी जो किडनी बेसिकली ईच एंड एवरी पर्सन हैज़ हिज आइडेंटिटी. गवर्नमेंट ने एक आधार कार्ड बना दिया है. हम लोग यूरिन एग्जामिनेशन को भी किडनी का आधार कार्ड कह सकते हैं, कुंडली कह सकते हैं बेसिकली, क्योंकि इसमें छोटी छोटी चीज़ें छुपी होती हैं जो कि हमें मदद करेंगी. इनिशियली फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल जस्ट एक किडनी फंक्शन, इनिशियली एक तो स्लाइड में हम लोग किडनी फंक्शन के बारे में जानते हैं. किडनी बेसिकली हम लोग का ब्लड वॉल्यूम और कंपोजिशन कंट्रोल करता है. बेसिकली जितने भी एक्सेस वेस्ट प्रोडक्ट हैं वो बाहर निकालेगा, जितना भी एक्सेस वाटर है या डिहाइड्रेटेड स्टेट में वाटर को कंजर्व करना है वो करेगा. सम ऑफ द हार्मोन्स लाइक रेनिन, एरिथ्रोपोइटिन, ये सारी चीज़ें किडनी से सेक्रेट होती हैं. As such, there is no universal definition of urine, but to define, urine is a liquid that contains multiple waste products of metabolism, especially urea and other metabolites, nitrogen waste that are filtered from the blood by the kidneys. How the urine forms? जो भी blood enter करता है kidneys में renal artery के through, finally the glomes, ये सबसे important है हम लोग के glomes. एफरेंट आर्टेरियोल और एफरेंट आर्टेरियोल के प्रेशर के डिफरेंस के साथ वो फिल्ट्रेट होता है. ये फिल्ट्रेट अगर पूरा का पूरा बाहर आ जाए तो अराउंड 180 लीटर है. यहाँ से ज़्यादातर अच्छी चीज़ें अप्रॉक्सीमेट टिब्यूल्स में रीअब्जॉर्ब हो जाती हैं, और कुछ वेस्ट प्रोडक्ट जो इंटरस्टीशियम वाला पार्ट है वहाँ से वापस टिब्यूल्स में आती हैं सेक्रेट होने के लिए. जितनी भी अच्छी चीज़ें हैं किडनी ने उन सबको प्रिजर्व किया है, जो बेकार चीज़ें हैं वो यूरिन के थ्रू फिल्टर होती हैं. और नॉर्मल यूरिन वॉल्यूम इज अराउंड 700 to 1.5 लीटर, ये पूरे दिन में निकलना है. इस स्लाइड को हम लोग ध्यान रखते हैं, जितने जहाँ जहाँ किडनी अफेक्ट होगी, ग्लोम्स में फिल्ट होगी उसकी यूरिन फाइंडिंग अलग होगी, तो ब्यूज में इन्वॉल्व होगा उसकी यूरिन फाइंडिंग अलग होगी, इंटरस्टीशियम में इन्वॉल्व होगा तो उसकी यूरिन फाइंडिंग थोड़ी थोड़ी अलग होती है. छोटी छोटी चीज़ें हम लोग को मदद करती हैं पहचानने में कि किडनी का कौन सा पार्ट अफेक्टेड है. So urine analysis is very informative, basically non-invasive, simple test and easily available each and everywhere basically. ये एक central role play करता है ये पता करने के लिए कि kidney injury is acute or chronic basically. कुछ findings ऐसी होंगी जैसे मैम ने बताया कि वो acute kidney injury में मिलती हैं. acute kidney injury में usually हम RBCs पाएंगे, मतलब अगर glomes का inflammation हो रहा है तो RBCs मिलेंगी. जो है chronic kidney disease usually specific gravity या वैक्सी कास्ट, बहुत ज़्यादा फाइंडिंग्स क्रोनिक किडनी डिजीज में नहीं मिले. इट मे बी द फर्स्ट एविडेंस ऑफ अंडरलाइंग किडनी डिजीज इवन इन एन अदरवाइज एसिम्प्टोमेटिक पेशेंट. अपने वहाँ इंडिया में यूजली स्क्रीनिंग का प्रोटोकॉल नहीं है, बट सम ऑफ द कंट्रीज लाइक जापान वहाँ पे बच्चों में स्क्रीन करते हैं. यूरिन एग्जामिनेशन इज मस्ट, क्योंकि आईजी नेफ्रोपैथी मतलब वन ऑफ द मोस्ट कॉमन ग्लोमेरुलर डिजीज इज कॉमन इन इंडिया एज वेल एज अदर कंट्रीज ऑल्सो. उन सब में क्या होता है कि बेसिकली एसिम्प्टोमेटिक बच्चे ही हैं, ज़्यादातर बच्चों में कोई सिम्टम नहीं है, कोई एडिमा नहीं है, बट सम माइनर प्रोटीनूरिया, वन और टू आरबीसीज यूजली बैप्स इंडिकेटेड नहीं होती है, बट उन बच्चों को फॉलो करना रहता है बेसिकली. हम लोग अपनी ओपीडी प्रैक्टिस में भी डे टू डे जो देखते हैं पेशेंट, ज़्यादातर पेशेंट यंग एडल्ट आते हैं जिनमें कोई कॉज नहीं पता है. नॉर्मल साइज किडनीज हैं, क्रिएटिनिन इज अराउंड 2 or 3, हाइपरटेंसिव, प्रोटीनूरिया और बेसिकली सब में आरबीसीज मिलते रहते हैं. उनमें जब भी बायोप्सी करके देखा गया है, ज़्यादातर पेशेंट जो हम लोगों ने फॉलो किया आईजी रेफ्रोपैथी मिलते हैं, जिनकी प्रोग्नोसिस बहुत, क्योंकि लेट पता चलती है, प्रोग्नोसिस बहुत अच्छी है, रैपिडली प्रोग्रेस कर जाते हैं और एंडोसिस के लिए एलिजिबल हो जाते हैं.
इन लोगों में अगर किडनी मतलब बायोप्सीज अर्ली हो जाए जहां जरूरत पड़ रही है तो ये सब सेव किए जा सकते हैं, एंड डिसीज से बचाए जा सकते हैं। बहुत से जो एस्टैब्लिश किडनी डिजीज है उनको फॉलो करने में भी यूरिन हेल्प करता है। एक सिंपल जो बच्चे आते हैं नेफ्रोटिक वाले उनको कैसे मॉनिटर करना है, सिंपल टेस्ट से यूरिन में अगर प्रोटीन नहीं आ रहा है जर्मिनेशन में है, और अगर उनमें प्रोटीन आ रहा है तो फिर स्टेरॉइड को और या तो चेकअप करना है या फिर अदर सेकेंड लाइन ऑफ थेरेपी भी स्टार्ट करना है। देयर आर बेसिकली थ्री स्टेप्स हम लोग को यूरिन देखते हैं। फर्स्ट उसका फिजिकल अपीयरेंस देखना है, केमिकल टेस्ट ज़्यादातर आजकल स्ट्रिप्स पे हैं, मैक्सिमम जो लैब्स फॉलो करती हैं वो स्ट्रिप्स को ही फॉलो करती हैं, एंड द थर्ड वन एंड मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट इज माइक्रोस्कोपी, दैट इज बेस्ड ऑन पैथोलॉजिस्ट कितना अच्छा होता है उस पर डिपेंड करता है कि पैथोलॉजिस्ट कितना अच्छा उसको कर रहे हैं। सो दिस इज द डायग्राम, व्हाट वी सी इन द फिजिकल एग्जामिनेशन इज कलर अपीयरेंस वॉल्यूम स्पेसिफिक ग्रेविटी, केमिकल एग्जामिनेशन पीएच शुगर प्रोटीन। I just emphasize basically those part which we are dealing in the OPD. How to properly collect the urine? Basically, we should always explain the patient to clean the external genitalias and it should be midstream sample. The sample should be examined, conducted within 2 hours of the collection, or if in the delay, it can be refrigerated basically. And proper before examination, it should be rewarmed basically. The urine sample can be random, it could be first morning or 24 hour collection. The random sample is, most of the sample are random, but the most important sample is first morning because that urine is basically concentrated. And specific gravity is best measured in the morning sample. Basically, if we examine the first sample and the specific gravity is less than 1.1, it means that the concentrating ability of the kidneys are less. What are the physicochemical properties? Color of the urine, usually normal color ranges from pale yellow to deep amber. If patient is dehydrated, the color turns to be deep amber, but that is not abnormal. The most changes of color in the urine are harmless and temporary, and maybe due to certain foods. The beetroot can turn the urine to the red. Dyes, food drinks, supplement like vitamins can change the color to mostly yellow. These are the different color of the urine: light yellow, amber, red, brown. The most important to distinguish is the red or brown. These color may be normally found, light yellow or amber color can be normally found in the urine. The red color urine, I just saw a flow chart basically. If we centrifuge the urine, if sediment is red, then there is clear cut urea. If supernatant is the red, then we should perform the dipstick. If a stick is negative, that can maybe because of other causes other than glomerular problems. If it is positive, if the stick is positive for the heme, then it can be because of myoglobin or hemoglobin. Then we see the color of plasma. Basically, myoglobin is freely filtered in the glomes and it didn't change the color of the plasma basically. So if plasma color is clear, then it is myoglobinuria, which is being commonly found in the clinical setting. Some of the athletes come or basically जो भर्ती के लिए जाते हैं पुलिस में कि सर सुबह सुबह चार घंटे चार आठ किलोमीटर दौड़े उसके सडनली गिर गए, वो रिनल फेलियर के साथ ही आते हैं। मैक्सिमम केसेज होते हैं रैप्टोमायलिसिस की वजह से होते हैं। एंड इफ प्लाज्मा कलर इज रेड, देन इट कुड बी बिकॉज ऑफ हीमोग्लोबिनुरिया। वाइट कलर यूरिन, दिस पेशेंट यूजली केम इन द ओपीडी विद, टिपिकली बताते हैं सर कि जो यूरिन हो रहा है वो बिल्कुल मतलब दूध की तरह हो रहा है बेसिकली। So this is because of chyluria. Some of the patient, basically catheterized patient, particularly come with the phosphate crystals. Basically, जो catheter में white white deposits होते हैं, they are usually phosphate crystals. Pink color rare is pink color uric acid crystal or green color. It can be because of pseudomonas. ये commonly इस OPD में नहीं मिलेंगे, but the most common है वो chyluria है and red color urine. Now the appearance of urine, usually urine color is clear, it can be slightly cloudy. Cloudy color urine can be because of some of the time it normally can be present with mucus or sperm or prosthetic fluid. But if it can be because of RBCs or white blood cells and needs require attention.
volume basically not equal. Usually urine color is basically normally it's mild smell, or it generally didn't have any odor. But a normal pungent odor of the urine, which usually is smell in the urinals, that is because of production of ammonia by bacteria. Presence of ketones in the urine may cause the urine to have sweet or fruity odor. Now the specific gravity, the normal specific gravity is 1.015 to 1.025. The specific gravity is directly proportional to urine osmolality, the solute concentration and urine density, or the ability of kidney to concentrate or dilute the urine over time over that of plasma ability. Valuable tests as concentrating ability of the kidney is among the first sign of renal tubular disorder. Basically, the concentration of urine is because of tubular reabsorption. So if tubules are affected, then reabsorption is less and more of the urine, diluted urine, are present over the time. कई बार ऐसा होता है कि हम लोग ओबीडी में देखते हैं कि क्रिएटिनिन अराउंड 7, 8, 10 है और पेशेंट का यूरिन आउटपुट बहुत अच्छा है. बेसिकली बहुत से पेशेंट आ रहे हैं और सब पेशाब तो हो रहा है लेकिन क्रिएटिनिन बढ़ा हुआ है. दे डिडंट वांट, उनको डायलिसिस नहीं कराना है. बेसिकली ज़्यादातर लोगों के दिमाग में पेशेंट में होता है कि पेशाब तो बहुत अच्छा आ रहा है, क्रिएटिनिन क्यों बढ़ा हुआ है. बिकॉज इफ इवन 5 or 10% ऑफ किडनी इज फंक्शनिंग, उनमें ट्यूबुलर रीअब्जॉर्प्शन ही नहीं है. बेसिकली जो यूरिन आता है वेस्ट यूरिन है, उसमें कोई भी कंसंट्रेशन एबिलिटी नहीं है, तो वो यूरिन बिल्कुल भी वेस्ट है, उसका कोई फंक्शन बहुत ज्यादा नहीं है. सम ऑफ द कॉजेज ऑफ नॉन पैथोलॉजिकल कॉजेज ऑफ डिक्रीज स्पेसिफिक ग्रेविटी, हम ज्यादा से ज्यादा वाटर अगर कंजम कर रहे हैं तो भी जो है बेसिकली स्पेसिफिक ग्रेविटी कम होगी. डायरेक्टिक ले रहे हैं या पेरेंटल फ्लूइड ले रहे हैं, अगर ये कॉजेज नहीं है देन द पैथोलॉजिकल कॉजेज आर डायबिटीज इंसिपिटस और एंडस्टेज रीनल डिजीज. इंक्रीज स्पेसिफिक ग्रेविटी इज यूजली सीन विथ डिक्रीज वाटर इनटेक, दैट इज नॉन पैथोलॉजिकल, और हाई एनवायरमेंटल टेम्परेचर. बट सम ऑफ द पैथोलॉजिकल कंडीशन लाइक डिहाइड्रेशन, फीवर, डायबिटीज मेलाइटिस, और द स्टेट वेयर एबनॉर्मल सोल्यूट्स आर प्रेजेंट इन द यूरिन. Basically, specific gravity depends on the component, basically solutes and its size also. Protein and glucose are basically heavy molecular weight. So if they are present in the urine, they show high specific gravity, which is not of much importance. Osmolality of the urine, that is determination of urine osmolality, is more important than specific gravity because it is gives more accurate reflection of the concentration of dissolved substance. It is measure of moles of dissolved particle, undissociated molecules and ions, and contained in a kilogram of per solvent. The normal osmolality of the random urine specimen varies from 40 to 1300 milliosmol per kg. Now the chemical examination that is done by reagent strip. The test performed within 1 hour after the collection. All refrigerated specimen to return the room temperature. Dip strip in fresh urine and compare color on pad to the color of chart after appearance on the time period. It should be briefly dipped in the urine. The time is important. Basically, उस chart में ज़्यादातर में times लिखा होता है कितने time के बाद उसको read करना है. Now the glucose, basically it's important screening test. कई बार ऐसा होता है कि पेशेंट आया ओपीडी में और शुगर नहीं है, हम लोगों ने रूटीन के बेटा पता चला कि स्ट्रिप टेस्ट 2+3+ शो कर रहा है, तो जो अनडायग्नोज डायबिटिक है वो भी स्ट्रिप टेस्ट से डायग्नोज हुआ है. बिलिरुबिन इज अ बाई प्रोडक्ट ऑफ ब्रेक डाउन ऑफ हीमोग्लोबिन दैट नॉर्मली कंटेन्स डिपस्टिक ड्रिंक्स नॉर्मली कंटेन बिलिरुबिन. इट्स प्रेजेंस सो इंडिकेशन ऑफ लिवर डिजीज, बाइल डक्ट ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन और हेपेटाइटिस. Ketones are also not normally present. It is excreted when the body metabolizes fat incompletely. Blood. Presence of blood may indicate infection, trauma, urinary tract, or bleeding from the kidney. False positive reading. You always take history of menstrual bleed. If a woman in around 20-30 year of age they come, so if urine shows RBCs, always ask the menstrual history. pH is also very important too for renal disease. Basically the agar koi bhi patient metabolic acidosis ka hai, usually urine jo hai zyada se zyada acid jo hai excrete karne ki koshish karegi, lekin agar tubule proper function nahi kar rahe hain to
ट्यूबुलर एक्सक्रीशन जो एसिड का है वो कम हो जाता है. सो इफ अ पेशेंट ऑफ मेटाबॉलिक एसिडोसिस ड्यूरिंग पीएच इज नॉट बिलो 5, इट मींस कि ट्यूबुलर एसिडोसिस वाला पेशेंट है. जो एसिडोसिस है दैट इज बिकॉज ऑफ रीनल ट्यूबुलर एसिडोसिस. Now about the protein, basically depositic is also good for albuminuria. Basically it is insensitive for non-albumina protein. So ज़्यादातर patients में screening के लिए depositic is good, but it usually didn't detect microalbuminuria. और macro में भी अगर diluted urine है तो भी falsely negative आ जाता है कई बार. एक और इम्पोर्टेंट इसमें क्या है कि यूरिन टेस्ट में ये एल्ब्यूमिन को नहीं, एल्ब्यूमिन के अलावा नॉन एल्ब्यूमिन प्रोटीन है जो हीमोग्लोबिन लाइट चेन है उनको नहीं पकड़ पाता है. उनके लिए सल्फोसैलिक एसिड टेस्ट है. सो अगर हम किसी भी पेशेंट को डिपोस्टिक के आमने अगर वो नेगेटिव है और सल्फोसैलिक एसिड टेस्ट किया और वो पॉजिटिव आ रहा है, इट मीन्स पेशेंट को जो है वो नॉन एल्ब्यूमिन वाला प्रोटीन निकल रहा है, दैट इज यूजली लाइट चेन. और हमें फिर उन पेशेंट में माइलोमा के लिए वर्कअप करना होता है. नाइट्रेट और ल्यूकोसाइट स्ट्रेज ये दोनों जो हैं वो हेल्प करते हैं हम लोग को बेसिकली इन्फेक्शंस रिलेटेड प्रॉब्लम के लिए. सो नॉर्मली द डिपोस्टिक टेस्ट इज नेगेटिव फॉर ग्लूकोज, कीटोन्स, बिलिरुबिन, नाइट्राइट, ल्यूकोसाइट स्ट्रेज एंड ब्लड. प्रोटीन कैन बी नेगेटिव और ट्रेस पॉजिटिव. पीएच इज यूजली अराउंड 4.5 to 8. दिस इज नॉट इम्पोर्टेंट प्रोसीजर. This is the basically table of chart के most of the जो single compile किया हुआ है यहाँ पे. Microscopy is important. Microscopy में हम लोग को WBC, RBC, epithelial cells, crystal बहुत सारे जो findings आती हैं, तो बहुत सारे में cast होता है, किसी में crystal होता है, किसी में epithelial cells होता है, उनकी क्या significance है वो देखते हैं. WBC basically most commonly normal sperm मतलब centrifuge में 0 to 4 positive रह सकता है, that didn't significance. Pyuria और infection usually 5 plus पे हम कह सकते हैं कि अगर 5 से ज़्यादा है तो pyuria show कर रहा है. Urinary neutrophils are commonly associated with bacteria. अगर पेशेंट के यूरिन में पसल्स आ रहे हैं और कल्चर्स नेगेटिव हैं, दैट इज स्टराइल पाइवोरिया, व्हाट एवर कॉजेस बेसिकली इंटरस्टीशियल नेफ्राइटिस और रीनल ट्यूबरक्लोसिस और नेफ्रोलिसिस, और हमें फिर उसके लिए वर्कअप करने की जरूरत होती है. इसिनोफिलिया एनीमिया अगर मिल रहा है, दैट इज इंपॉर्टेंट मार्कर फॉर एक्यूट इंटरस्टीशियल नेफ्राइटिस. आरबीसीज इन द यूरिन बेसिकली ये कॉमन कॉजेस हैं जो हर एज ग्रुप के कॉजेस हैं. इन almost in all age group we should work up for the glomerular disease, but in the younger age it is transiently unexplained. Some of the causes are UTI, but after the 40 we should also work up for the cancer of the bladder, kidney or prostate, and in the later age it should be work up for benign prostatic hyperplasia. How to distinguish between extra glomerular or glomerular? Basically hum log ke important nephrologist ke liye glomerular origin ka hai और न्यूरोलॉजिस्ट के लिए एक्स्ट्रा ग्लोमेरुलर. बेसिकली जो भी चीज़ ग्लोम से होकर निकलेगी वो ऑलवेज मतलब आरबीसीज टूटी होगी, क्योंकि ग्लोम से कुछ फिल्टर हो रहा है तो टूट के ही फिल्टर होगा बेसिकली. वहाँ जो भी मिलेगा वो टूटा फूटा वो मिलेगा. ग्लोमेरुलर वजह की जो भी आरबीसीज होंगी वो टूटी होगी. यूजली कोला कलर मिलता है. आरबीसीज अगर ट्यूब्यूल्स के थ्रू आ रही है तो कास्ट साथ साथ में लेके आएंगे, तो अगर आरबीसी कास्ट है इसका मतलब कि वो जो इमेचुरिया है वो ग्लोमेरुलर वजह का है. अगर कास्ट नहीं है इट मीन्स एक्स्ट्रा ग्लोमेरुलर. कोई भी ट्यूब मतलब नीचे जो यूरोजरी प्रॉब्लम है यूरेटर से है या नीचे ब्लैडर से है, ऊपर से नहीं होता है. यूजली प्रोटीनिया भी जो है एक्स्ट्रा ग्लोमेरुलर लेस देन 500 है. ग्लोमेरुलर वर्जिन में किसी भी रेंज में हो सकता है, 500 से लेके इवन ग्राम्स तक. दिस आर द नॉर्मल मॉर्फोलॉजी. बेसिकली फेस कंट्रास्ट मॉर्फोलॉजी है. माइक्रोस्कोपी है बेसिकली रेड ब्लड सेल्स की जो है. एंड दिस आर द डिस्मॉर्फिक ऑर्गेनिज्म. एक इम्पॉर्टेंट और एथिंकोसाइट्स बेसिकली जो एरो बनी हुई है, दे आर एथिंकोसाइट्स. एथिंकोसाइट्स बेसिकली आर रिंग शेप्ड आरबीसीज विथ वेसिकल शेप प्रोड्यूस. Thank you.
I'd like to request Dr. Amit to give the prize to Dr. Ashwini Agarwal, sir. Dr. Amit Bansal. Is celebrated with the parade of elephants. I think Dr. Yes. In Mysore, Karnataka, this is. So I would like to request Dr. Rajesh Gupta sir to please give the prize. The options yourself.
B.
Raise your hand.
A.
Raise your hand.
Ma'am, they
what did you say?
No, पीछे it's the philosopher's stone. Okay, sorry, I didn't. Indian Railways. Dr. Sandeep Chaudhary? Sandeep Chaudhary.
Yes. Okay, thank you for the Sandeep Chaudhary. Yes, great. So the next question is, which of the following is not an example of operating system?
BSD Unix.
We are moving towards next question. Just raise your hand. Don't answer the question. So what is the name of the disease in man arising out of vitamin B1 deficiency? Just raise your hand.
Dr. Gupta.
Dr. A.K. Chaturvedi, sir. Dr. Amit Kumar Srivastav. And the one faculty from Dr. Devesh Pratap Singh as a chairperson. And I'd like to request Dr.
And he is going to speak on investigations in kidney diseases.
सर आपने फोटो पहले देखा सर इसीलिए
कलर चेंज हो गया
कलर स्टाइल तो वही है
Very glad to present this talk in front of my teacher, respected Professor Anupa Kaur ma'am. My topic is how to evaluate the patient with renal disease. I am presenting the very basic things. You all know, but it's just a reminder. starting with who need to a nephrologist opinion. Actually, initially this is not patient, it's a responsibility of primary physician or primary medical physician or primary surgeon. There are three major reasons for referral to nephrologist are asymptomatic individual with renal diseases, symptomatic renal disease and some other systemic diseases which were involved with that clinical significance and limitation, and imagine studies sequence of first choice according to clinical condition, and with two antihypertensive medications, the duration of hypertension was not clear, and her serum creatinine was value was between 1.2 to 1.3 for last 4 months, and there is no proteinuria and hematuria with 6 to 8 WBCs and urine analysis. And she wants to know whether or not she had kidney disease. So which of the following statement is correct regarding her renal condition? she has no, she cannot be classified as CKD because her serum creatinine was within normal limits. C and D, we all know. Coming to the next slide, okay, importance of glomerular filtration rate. The serum creatinine is the most common investigation for the evaluation of renal disease. But the what extent renal disease happens, the serum creatinine is the most commonly used investigation for that. The merit of this is this can under and overestimate the renal failure status, and this leads mainly to the under and overdosing of drugs in ICU setting especially and in hospitalized patient, and it can delay the intervention. This graph shows the there is no non-linear relationship between the GFR and serum creatinine. Initially there is a large change in GFR, but serum creatinine value is increased by very much less. Despite of this, normal serum creatinine does not signify that GFR of the patient is not impaired. This is the short introduction of glomerular filtration. It is the product of average filtration by the itch and the throat. And normal GFR level is 130 for men and 120 for the women. And mean rate of decline of GFR after the age of 40 years is 0.75 mL per minute per year. And during pregnancy, the GFR increased about 50% in the first day, either measurement of GFR or estimation of GFR. With the exogenous filtration marker, we can laser the DFR, and this is better than what we estimated in clinical practice. And technetium 99 DTP is the most commonly used radio tracer for the calculation of exogenous as an exogenous filtration marker for the GFR. In endogenous filtration marker, we have urea, serum creatinine, and cystatin C. In which urea containing quotients are most commonly used, and cystatin C is not in clinical practice at now. And several novel endogenous markers like beta trace protein, beta 2 microglobulin, and symmetric dimethyl arginine. There are some advantage and disadvantage of creatinine and cystatin C. Actually, the disadvantage of creatinine is varies with the muscle mass, dietary protein intake, and varies with the sex and race. The only disadvantage of cystatin C is increases in the hyperthyroid state, is increase in the steroid use, and it can vary with the race also. The sources of error in the measurement of creatinine. Every clinician should aware of the complexities of the creatinine measurement and how they may be relevant to the day-to-day clinical practice. Actually, there are commonly used methods for the creatinine estimation. The most commonly used, still most commonly used method is the Jaffe method, that is alkaline picrate method. Other is enzymatic and IDMS method and HPLC method. And there is wide variation in the creatinine concentration predominantly because of the difference in the instrument calibration among the manufacturers. So, nearly all clinical laboratory methods are now expected to calibrate the serum creatinine according to IDMS reference. So every clinician must be aware of this, and they should precise in selecting their labs. They must be IDMS standardized serum creatinine lab. And actually, another importance is the MDRD and CKD API equation for the GFR calculation was based on this IDMS reference serum creatinine value. For the estimating the kidney function, we have Cockroft-Gold formula, MDRD equation, CKD API 2009-2021. I am coming to the only disadvantage of different formula, demerits of different formula. Cockroft-Gold, we using the serum creatinine, we using the body weight as a measurement of GFR. This is disadvantage because of the obese person. muscle mass is less, and this can result in the false result. The MDRD equation, demerit of the MDRD equation, it is not our value. The MDRD equation is less predictive. Among the all CKD, PI is the best equation. And for the pediatric patient up to 11 years of the age, we can use the Schwartz equation for the GFR calculation. Now, question regarding the equations. Mainly, its answer is important. The CKD PI equation is more accurate in estimating the GFR than MDRD study equation. It is correct answer. The CKD PI equation is higher false positive diagnosis of CKD. It's a wrong answer because CKD PI equation can be used, can estimate the higher GFR with true precision. So, it's a less false positive value than the MDRD equation. CKD equation have a more accurate prediction for adverse outcome, and drug dosing using CKD equation is more accurate than the MDRD equation. Now this is a case scenario. An 89-year-old cachectic woman is transferred from nursing home for the evaluation of fever and tachycardia. She weighs 50 kg. Her urine culture grows E. coli that is sensitive to gentamicin only. Her lying sitting BP pulse rate are suggestive of orthostatic changes. And her serum creatinine was 0.9. And GFR is more than 60. Which of the following equation test is more useful for adjusting the gentamicin dose? The MDRD equation to approve gold, 24-hour creatinine clearance, hyothalamate clearance, or Schwartz equation. Because of the MDRD equation is not valid for the extreme of the ages, and 24-hour serum creatinine clearance is less feasible in this case, and hyothalamate clearance intended the radio tracer. And Schwartz equation is for the pediatric patient. So in this patient, Cockroach Gold equation can be used for the calculation of the GFR for drug dosing. The limitation of the MDRD equation is that it cannot be applied to the extreme of the ages, obesity, malnutrition, skeletal muscle disease, paraplasia, quadriplasia, vegetarians, in case of acute kidney injury, pregnancy. Dosing is drug dosing of renally excreted drugs in ACM population, because it was not validated in the ACM population. Coming to the again to the case scenario one, that is the 50-year female with the creatinine of between 1.2 to 1.3. The estimated GFR from different formula shows the all the patients in the CKD stage 3A. It shows that the normal creatinine value does not signify the patient having now the CKD. And the ultrasound examination shows the right kidney of 8.4 cm with slight decreased CMD. And left kidney with normal size, there is no hydroxyurea, and post-bite residual urine is 10 ml. And proteinuria is just 300 mg per day. Before further proceeding, I will discuss the suggested imaging in the renal lesions. What is the first line investigation we should use for the diagnosis of renal lesions? In acute kidney injury and chronic kidney disease, the ultrasound, definitely the ultrasound is the first examination. In hematuria, we can either use CT or ultrasound. Proteinuria and nephrotic syndrome, again the ultrasound. The hypertension with normal renal function, ultrasound is the first investigation, and if we are suspecting the renal artery stenosis, then we can do further CT and MR angio. With impaired renal function, we should use the renal Doppler in spite of CT and MR angio. And for the diagnosis of hydronephrosis, which is identified in the ultrasound, the first line of investigation is the nuclear renogram. This is very basic thing. Just to remind that every clinician must show itself by the film. They should not go by the report. This is very important. Normal ultrasound is ultrasound imaging has hypoechoic cortex and hyperechoic medulla.
like exposure is and for the quadratic size calculation, there is formula of 0.30 into h plus 5.2. These are the common cause of abnormal renal sizes. There is large size, which is both unilateral and bilateral, and small sizes, unilateral and bilateral. I am not going into detail, but I have discussed these are all the differential diagnoses. The congenital hypoplasia, the renal artery stenosis, chronic renal artery stenosis is the likely diagnosis. Before proceeding to the higher level of investigation, we should examine the patient to look for the some renal bruit or some abdominal bruit or all the limbs, four limbs, people should be measured to look for another evidence of any arterial disease. Coming to the before proceeding to the investigation, coming to the case scenario 3, a 43-year-old woman with type 2 diabetes presented to the acute coronary syndrome, and she had CKD stage 2 and hypertension with albuminuria 150 mg per day, and she is on low dose of diuretic. All mentioned are the risk factors for the contrast induced AKI, like diabetes, albuminuria, CKD, acute MI, and in all of that, the pre-existing CKD is the strongest risk factor for the that contrast induced neutropenia. Coming to the contrast induced acute kidney injury, the definition is defined by KDIGO working group, was the same definition used to define the AKI. It is plasma creatinine rising more than 1.5 times over the baseline value last for the last 7 days, decrease in urine output of 0.5 units per kg for the 24 hours for 6 hours, and acute rise in serum creatinine 48 hours of 0.3 mg per deciliter after the administration of contrast. Because many are confounding factors in the contrast induced neutropathy, like in acute MI there is episode of hypotension, there may be the two important mechanisms. Coming to the continuation of case scenario 3, the above patient, which is a coronary angiography patient, is admitted and referred to for the evaluation of contrast induced AKI and its prevention. Which of the following strategies recommended to prevent the contrast induced AKI? By car with placebo and acetylcysteine. It shows that the neither IV soda bicarb nor acetylcysteine has any effect in reducing the contrast induced nephropathy after the angiography. So the only role of 0.9% normal saline is there in contrast prevention of contrast induced AKI. So this is the simple management for the patient receiving the alternated contrast media. Very simplified management. We have to estimate the GFR using the MDRD or CKD API equation. If the GFR is less than 6, positive in the skin, bone, heart, lung, lymph node, liver and other organs, and it is excreted by the kidney, and nephrogenic systemic fibrosis develops anywhere from 2 days to 18 months in the patient with AKI, CKD stage 4, 5 and dialysis stage. Gadolinium based contrast agent such as OmniScan, Megabase and Optimax are contraindicated in the patient with AKI and patient with hemodialysis. These are measures to prevent the nephrogenic systemic fibrosis in patients with AKI with a different renal function. In the stage 1 CKD, that is GFR of more than 90, there is no risk of nephrogenic systemic fibrosis. It was not reported. In stage 2, in nephrography, we use radio tracers that are designed to accumulate in the tissue, and for organs on the basis of underlying function, unique to that organ. And in this gamma camera captures the photos from the radio tracer, which patient generates the image. These are three agents, three types of agents used in the nuclear imaging: the globular filtration agent, regular filtration agent, and regular filtration agent. Tubular secreting agent mostly being used to measure the GFR, and tubular secreting agent is being mostly used to GFR with the I have already discussed the choice of radionucleotide imaging. Now coming to the case scenario one. In this case, the CT angiography done with no evidence of renal osteogenesis and some peeling defect which is likely a scar. So for detecting the scar, the best nuclear imaging is the DMSA scan. DMSA scan we have done and shows the cortical scar in both right and left kidney. Definitely right kidney has more cortical scar than the left kidney. And this patient is this can be a scar, can be congenital. There is a congenital anomaly of kidney and urinary tract. Maybe in the past, she has reflux nephropathy. Active urine sediment, the RBC is in the area. And children of more than 11 years and less than 1 year of the age. For the less than 1 year of the age, it is likely to have minimal changes because of the congenital nephrotic syndrome is more common in less than 1 year children. So kidney biopsy is indicated in that children. In acute kidney disease, if kidney biopsy is indicated if the obstruction reduced renal perfusion, there is obvious if there is 160 of systolic and less than 95 of diastolic, urine culture should be sterile. And we have to stop sterile clopidogrel warfarin 7 days before the biopsy. And subcutaneous heparin can be stopped 24 hours before the biopsy. Now coming to the diabetic kidney disease part, which patients of the diabetes and renal dysfunction needs the kidney biopsy. Coming to the case scenario, a 52-year-old woman with type 2 diabetes diagnosed 1 year ago, referred for the evaluation of proteinuria noted in first 3 months ago. A family history of positive for diabetic nephropathy, physical examination showed the blood pressure of 149 and there is normal fundus examination, but labs and symptoms of NDKD, other systemic disease. And absence of retinopathy is important in case of type 1 diabetes. This is not important in type 2 diabetes. That is all my discussion.
We see in hypoparathyroid cases, usually they have low serum calcium levels, so they are bound to take a lot of calcium. Now, what should we do in these?
And we were very, it's indicated we should give, but we have to have a clear watch over the calcium levels and the indication for what the calcium is being given.
Very nice presentation by Dr. Rai, and more often in ICU. Is there any biomarker with high predictive value, possibility value? We can predict that who is going to develop AKI or any biomarker.
Actually, there are many liver biomarkers available validated for the detection of acute kidney injury, like beta-2 microglobulin, beta-3S protein, phospholipase like epsilon C, but they are currently not in use. We are detecting only we can rely on serum creatinine value and the urine output. The urine output is very important in case of ICU patients. It can decline before the rising of serum creatinine. If these markers are available in future, they can be used for the detection of the acute kidney disease before the kidney damage
occurs. And secondly, I would like to emphasize that you are in medical college for the past few months and 6 months from December. You must have realized that what all talks we are doing, this is theoretical. Practically, the patients do not follow what you advise or we advise. Maybe due to their socioeconomic status or anything else. I am a man of neurotrauma and I have done my residency under Professor Rakesh Saxena. many practical things I have learned from you. I want to ask you. Maybe due to his social status, economic status, or anything else. Few times, very few times, we have encountered that is stable in all investigations up to 6 days. In medical college, where poor patients are there, we advise them to, they are not able to follow the investigations daily. After 3 days, in the 6 days post-injury, after 3 days they get a RFT done, the creatinine is raised. Raised to the level of 6 point something. 6 does not indicate hemodialysis. When I was resident, my friend was resident in medicine. I used to call him, he used to do PD, and we used to recover the patient. What is the ideal management of that patient?
Is the most important part, sir. Acute kidney injury and along with the volume status, drugs causing the renal injury like aminoglycoside, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, and especially in the neuro trauma patients, mannitol can cause the smoking diuresis, can cause the AKI. So daily monitoring is must.
Daily monitoring is must.
At least
if a patient is of a diffuse axonal injury, we have 5 days, then we can shift over to lactate and glycerol.
But we have to take care of the dehydration part.
Input-output maintained.
Yes, sir. In trauma patient, one situation, they can have the rhabdomyolysis also.
I suppose in medical college, for the past 6 years, two different aspects. Yes, sir. Patients always
certificate and application for Dr. Vijay Kumar Singh. Thank you. इस सीएमई का इंतजार बहुत दिन से था और इंतजार था सबको मैडम अनुपमा कौल का और इंतजार इसलिए था कि मैडम यहीं से बिलोंग करती हैं इनके कई बैचमेट्स डॉक्टर त्रिगुण साहब बहुत देर से कई दिनों से पूछे थे कब आने वाली है तो अल्टीमेटली बताया गया आज आने वाली है और इन सबके पीछे जो शख्सियत है वो मैडम अनुमा गुप्ता मैम है मुझे पता है सब बात अंदर क्या चल रही थी कि मैम ने ही मैम को बुलाया है तो थैंक यू मैम आज आप हम लोग के गुरु की भूमिका में थी और गुरु के बारे में क्या कहते हैं कि सब धरती कागज करूँ लिखनी सब बन राय सात समुंदर की मस करूँ गुरु गुरु लिखा ना जाए आज हमारे पास तीन तीन गुरु थे और खास बात ये थी कि दो गुरु के भी एक गुरु और तो मैम सबसे बड़ी गुरु थी
मैं पर्सनली ये कहना चाहूंगी कि व्हाट एवर आई एम टुडे बिकॉज ऑफ माय टीचर्स एंड सीनियर रेजिडेंट्स हु वर देयर हु टॉट मी व्हाट आई एम टुडे आई ऑलवेज फील कि हम लोग अपना जो नींव होता है वो नींव ऐसे नहीं बनता है हम लोग आज वो अचीव कर लिए वी आर वेरी हैप्पी दैट वी हैव अचीव्ड व्हाट वी आर इन लाइफ बट इट्स ऑल बिकॉज ऑफ आवर टीचर्स आई पर्सनली वांट टू थैंक डॉक्टर संजय गुप्ता सर डॉक्टर विजय पांडे सर आर के सी सर देयर वाज हम लोगों के डॉक्टर सो मेनी नेम्स टू कॉल अपॉन आई एम सो इंडेटेड टू देम क्योंकि ऐसा कोई भी टाइम नहीं था कि हम लोग आप आज के दिन में देखेंगे कि जब मैं डिस्कस कर रही थी अनुपम मैम से तो बस जस्ट वन थिंग टू टेल कि बीआरडी वाज नो लेस वी केम फ्रॉम अ प्लेस लाइक मेडिकल कॉलेज श्रीनगर द एंटायरली डिफरेंट सिनेरियो वाज ऑल टुगेदर एंड द मेडिकल कॉलेज एक्सेप्टेड अस बैचमेट एक्सेप्टेड अस आवर टीचर्स वाज सो नाइस एंड वॉट एवर वी आर टुडे इज ऑल बिकॉज ऑफ आवर टीचर्स आई वॉन्ट टू पर्सनली थैंक ईच वन ऑफ यू that whatever I am today is all because you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. और आज का टॉपिक किडनी का था. किडनी पे एक बात मुझे याद आती है. मैम इलाहाबाद में एक प्ले हुआ करता था, याद है आपको, जिसमें कि कोई हार्ट बनता था, कोई लीवर बनता था, कोई किडनी बनता था, कोई रेक्टम बनता था. उस समय किडनी को कोई अपनी गर्लफ्रेंड नहीं बनाता था कि ये तो आकर अब एक्सक्रीटरी है, कौन इससे बात करे. आज हमने देखा अगर किडनी फेल्योर हो जाए तो क्या हालत हो जाती है, सबके नाक नीची हो जाती है. तो किडनी की बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट हमारी लाइफ में. और थैंक यू मैम, थैंक यू ऑल.
Thank you.